As I prayed over this week, I thought we've got several options. And I just felt like the Holy Spirit said, you know, you prayed, you asked as a nation. We saw thousands and thousands meet at different state capitals praying for this election, more than has been seen in ages and ages and ages. Last election, 4 years ago, 25 million evangelical Christians sat home and didn't vote. 4 years ago. Guess what? Y'all came out to vote this time, didn't you? And it's super interesting, and we're not going to go into statistics, but I want you to know that I believe that this election is the outcome of prayer of the church. And it prayed, it connected, and obviously the sovereignty of God, and we're going to talk about that. However, can I preface this message by saying to you, God told me to preach this message no matter who won. He said, I'm sovereign. It doesn't matter in terms of his kingdom in your life. It doesn't matter which one won. The message was the same. Rest in my sovereignty. But I believe the difference again has been because of the prayers of the saints of saying, God, we care. We're concerned about our nation. So what do we do now? Where do we go from now? This is no time to sit down and say, whew, oh, good, it's all over. We got the president we want. There is no perfect president. They don't exist. There is much about our presidential candidate that won that I wasn't happy with, much. But you know what? There are no perfect presidents. There's no perfect men, no perfect women. Well, maybe a few. I think Cheryl was one. No? Okay. Don't confuse me with the facts. Resting in God's sovereign love. That's where he has us right now. And so what do we do now that it's here? First of all, this is like a porch on the house. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to say before I say it, and then I'm going to, at the end, tell you what I said. But here it is. Smile. Relax. And if Hillary would have won, it would have been the same message. Smile. Relax. God still is sovereign. Okay? God still loves his bride, the church. God still loves you. Is that awesome or what? God still loves this world and longs for it to receive Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus, the Jewish Messiah, who is the Savior of the world. He still will bless those who obey him. I love that song. I don't know who chose that, whether you did, Tom, or marvelous, marvelous song. You know, it's one thing to worship when everything's going great. It's something else to worship when you're hurting, when your heart hurts, when your head hurts, when your relationships aren't right, when there's pain in your heart, when things aren't going right, when your finances maybe aren't where they ought to be. That's the time to worship. That's the time to say, God, you're working something out in me. I don't know what it is, but I'm resting in you, God. God will still bless those who obey. He will still bless this nation. I'm hoping, and if the two of you could find, I think the words are on an icon there on your home screen. God bless America again. Do we have the words for that? Not God bless America. Yeah. God bless America. Land that island. That one. Okay. Good. God longs to bless this nation. Last week, I apologized to you because there were periods of sometimes weeks at a time where I just say, okay, America's done. We're seeing what I see. America's done. And some of you challenged me and said, Gordon, where's your faith? You know, come on. Just because it looks bad doesn't mean God isn't able to turn it around and bring good out of it. And so, you know, God is still able to bless this nation if we turn to him in repentance. And we saw that. I saw that for 3 or 4 months before the election. I saw Christians everywhere praying. I saw articles from people calling Christians to prayer that I do not remember seeing in the last election. It's amazing what God did. Here it is. Through the prayers of His people. Through the prayers of His people. God has an eternal plan for every one of you. Because your faith is in Christ as your Savior, you're going to spend heaven with Him. Where's it all going to end? What's going to... I don't know what's going to end. Relax. God loves you. He's got you in the palm of His hand. I think at least a couple of times I've been to visit you in the hospital and just said, God's got you right here. Right in the palm of His hand. Taking care of us. And here you are, sitting here healthy and looking, smiling. Praise God. All right. But that's only the beginning. So probably for most of you, this is a true statement. So I would think probably all of you, but I don't want to assume. So we got the president we think we wanted. It's all over, right? Now we can just go back to daily. No. Oh, there's much work to be done by the church on their knees in prayer for this nation. We have only just begun. Where do we go from here? What do we do? 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verses 1 and 2. I urge you first of all, speaking to believers, I urge you first of all, pray for all people. Yeah, we're going to pray for those filthy, rotten, vile sinners that are just, they're just... Wait a minute. Can you remember we're all in the original state, filthy, rotten, vile sinners? Every last one of us? So we say, pray for people. God wants it. We talked about that, and you talked about that in men's fellowship yesterday morning. God wants to give the church a new attitude. At times, the attitude of the church has been, well, we need to pray for those sinners. We're all sinners, saved by the grace of God. Just as God loved us and saved us, the church needs to rekindle a heart of compassion for the lost. We're trying to learn, and I pray America learns. Just because we disagree doesn't mean we don't love. In fact, sometimes it's our love that causes us to reach out to say, whoa, stop, don't, you're going to hurt yourself. You're going to hurt yourself. Certain behavioral choices, you're going to hurt yourself. Does the church love people? I don't mean preaching to them. I don't mean beating on them emotionally, telling them how wrong they are. I mean compassionately reaching out in love, saying, God loves you. He wants your life to be filled with His joy. Choose His way. Ask God to help them. Intercede on their behalf. That means care enough to pray for them. You know what I've discovered over the years? It's true. You can't be angry with somebody and pray for them. You can't hate them and pray for them. Not if you pray consistently for them. If you pray consistently for people, God's going to give you His heart for them, and His heart is love. He longs for all people to come into the kingdom of God just like you came into the kingdom of God. There are some that aren't there, and He longs that they would be there. Are we compassionately longing for them and praying for them and interceding for them? Give thanks in advance for them. What do we give thanks for? For what God is going to do in their lives. Well, he hasn't done anything yet. They're still the same old people. In some ways, so is the church. Still the same old people. There's some changes, but boy, there needs to be a whole lot more in us. At least I'll say in me. Give thanks for what God is going to do within them. Pray this way also for kings and for all who are in authority, and I guess that would include presidents, especially the president of the United States. Pray for the president of the United States. Pray for the current president. You know, wow. I have been blown away by the graciousness of our leaders to acquiesce to the will of the people. Now, I've not been impressed with or pleased with the people's response in many cases, but I have been blown away as our president-elect sat down with our president. You say what you want. There are many countries in the world where they don't sit down to discuss how to peacefully turn over the transition of power. They settle that with bullets and guns. That's the peaceful nation you live in. Wow. The transition of power, that's a tough job. Tough for those who are letting go, and tough for those who are trying to figure out, now what do I do? I heard one of the news commentators say, and I thought to myself, boy, is that true? People whom God uses in leadership have huge egos. I could go sit down now. Imagine having 8 years, despite what you may think of what President Obama did with that, imagine having 8 years in the White House. Where do you go from there? Imagine being Hillary, who was already picking out wallpaper and furniture for the White House. Not going. Imagine the man who, and I heard this comment, interesting, who for him to move in the White House is a step down from where he usually lives. Imagine the changes they will go through. Pastor, why are you spending time on this? Because they need our prayers. They need our prayers. And if you were there, you'd want those prayers too. Pray this way. Intercede. Pray. Ask God to help them. Give thanks in advance for what God is going to do with them. Pray this way for kings and all who are in authority, for Congress. Pray so that we can live peaceful, quiet lives of godliness and dignity. Whew. The unrest in Portland and LA and Denver and I talked with my son John and Chris and they live, I don't know, 3 hours from Denver, due south. And they said the roadways were just jammed because of what was going on in Denver, the protests in Denver.
It's about Portland. That's why the ones that were going back and forth on his birthday celebration, they were literally out on your super highway walking.
Yeah. And we pray that's all they were doing was walking.
Yeah.
It's part of what America is. You can protest, and you can protest peacefully, and everybody ought to support your right to protest. But when it turns to crime and the rest. So, you know, pray for this nation. So what do we do? Matthew 6:33. I mean, you know these passages, but God said put them together, get them out there so that people know what to do, the church knows what to do. Seek the kingdom of God first. I'm an American. I am. I'm a patriot. I am proud to be called an American. But do I want, is my number one focus the strengthening of America, or is my number one focus the building of God's kingdom, which will include the building up of America into a godly nation again? What's my focus? America or the kingdom of God? America, however long, and please don't assume that I mean any disrespect in this, I do not, but America's history is not permanent, it's temporary. The kingdom of God is eternal. And the kingdom of God lives within the United States of America, as well as around the world, as well as all of heaven and earth. What are we to do? We're to seek first the kingdom of God. Above all else, for our nation, nationally, politically, seek first, pray over that the kingdom of God may be released over our nation. That people will, and that's the next part of it, will live righteously on a personal level. Shared with you last week, you all know it well, that sin is a reproach to any people, that righteousness honors a nation. God honors those who live in righteousness, but cannot bless those who choose repeatedly over and over again as a culture to live in evil. He can't and won't bless that. It's not his nature. So we need to live righteously on a personal level. You know, all of us had thoughts and feelings as the character or lack thereof of our presidential candidates were dragged before the media for months and months and months. How would you feel if your character or lack thereof were dragged before the media? What are we praying for? We're asking that the righteousness of God be released within our candidates' lives, but also within our lives. America is a grassroots nation. Even our government started from within, the Joe average citizen, and came out of that. Unlike many other nations that are where there's royalty and families, and you know, our leadership comes from grassroots. You're the grassroots. What are you doing in prayer for this nation? God says, if you'll seek my kingdom first for your nation, above all else, and you will personally live righteously in your nation, God says, I will give you everything you need, both personally and as a nation. 2 Chronicles 7:14, it's been all over this church posted. If my people who are called by my name, what is his name? Christos, the Christ, the anointed one. What's our name? Christians. Christians. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, part of what was so awful in this election season was ego rising up against ego and all of it evil. Awful. Without a doubt, every commentator agrees, there has never been a worse election cycle than this one, ever in America's history. Awful. So what do? We need to pray that we get not a sense of, well, Democratic Party is right, Republican Party is right. No, God's way is right. And what do we know about God's way? Is it's his way. It's not mine. I have no skin in this game, as they used to say. Why? Because it's God's kingdom. It's not mine. And I am a servant of the kingdom of God. I may be a Republican, or I may be a Democrat, or I may be an American, but as a believer, I am first and foremost a child of God. And look to establish the kingdom of God in my country as well as in my life. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray, and the church did that this time, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. We just have an election. We don't even have the person we elected in the White House. You know, we haven't even just hardly begun. What do we need to pray? That God will hear from heaven and that he will forgive our nation's sins, of which there are many, and that he will heal our land. Part of why we desperately need prayers in America, and the church must not stop having so-called in their own mind won the election, now's no time to stop. Why? The election was won by, depending on which poll you see after it was all over, a half a point, 1 point percentage, 1.5 points percentage. America is just as divided today as it was before the election. Just as divided. We need the peace of Christ to settle over this nation. What do? Romans 13, 1 through 5. Submit to the governing authorities. Why should we submit to authorities? Because the word says all authority comes from God. All authority comes from God. So what about bad authority? Even in bad authority, the scripture says you learn to submit. And if there needs to be a civil uprising, then God will show you. I think we were not far from a civil uprising before this election and do have a civil uprising now in the wrong direction, now that we have an election, because they won't accept or are choosing, at least temporarily, not to accept the authority that God has established. Rebellion against authority is rebellion against God, because God establishes all rebellion. Excuse me. God establishes all authority. Sorry about that. Romans 13 goes on to say, so do what is right and they will honor you. Those in authority will honor you. Those in authority are God's servants. And then he finishes that with, you keep a clear conscience. Do what is right. If everybody in the country did what was right, can you imagine how God would lead this nation? The problem is we're like Israel, where it says, what? Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. So what do? We pray for our president-elect Trump, and we pray for President Obama, who's the outgoing president. What do we pray? We pray for humility, for a man who wrote the book on the art of the deal, for a man who's built and lost and rebuilt kingdoms, financial kingdoms, whose hotels span from the west to the east to the north, or excuse me, to the south. Can you imagine the ego in terms of, I won this election? God establishes authority. Pray. This is anecdotal. And what I mean by that is it is a story I heard from a relative of mine. I cannot prove it. I haven't seen it on national news. But he said he did. That about 4 or 5 weeks ago, candidate Trump was in a black inner city church, and the pastor gave an altar call. And he went forward. I don't know if anybody else had heard that. He went forward to ask for God to take over his life. I hope and pray that's true. Do you know what the ego will do? Well, this is one more belt on my, or notch on my belt. You know, that's what his human ego, yours and mine, would do the same. Well, this is about me. I will show them what I can do. No. I don't want to know what Trump will do. I want to know what God will do through him. And he's as human as you or me or anyone else. Pray for the 4,000. 4,000 appointees. I heard three networks say that he had to appoint 4,000 positions of people in the next 70 days. I pray that every one of those are born again, spirit-filled, love Jesus. pray for peace and pray for cooperation within Congress. You want a miracle? You want to see a miracle? Pray for peace and cooperation in Congress. That'd take a miracle. God's up to it. Pray for favor with our friends and favor with our enemies and those who are our frenemies. Sometimes we don't know if they're friends or enemies. Okay, pray for favor with those. Pray for God to triumph. I didn't say Trump evil. I said triumph over evil. Amen. Oh, come on. pray for God. Pray for good to triumph over evil. Pray for peace within our land. Right now, there's not peace. We're still at 49-51%. Headlong, locked in a battle. We need the peace of Christ in America. Church, pray for it. So what do? We rest in God's sovereign love. We pray, we live right, we try to live righteously ourselves by the help of God and the power of God, and we pray for our leadership, and the rest we say, here, God, the rest of the mess is yours. We trust you to make what should happen, happen. Rest in the sovereignty of God. Two real quick in closing. The Bible guarantees us that God is still on his throne. And again, I hate to repeat myself, but I would be preaching this prayer if Hillary had won the election. God is still on the throne. He's in charge. He knows what he's doing. He established authority, but if he had chosen her for whatever the purposes of his kingdom was, we should still be saying, we rest in God. God still answers prayer. Jesus still is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. No election will ever change that. The Holy Spirit still lives in believers. Every believer is the permanent residence of the Holy Spirit. He lives in you. The cross, not the government, is still our only true source of deliverance or salvation. Government wants to get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger so that it can meet everybody's needs, and instead it gets more corrupt and worse and worse and worse. Because government was never meant to meet all the needs of everybody. God was. And so he longs to do that. Christ is still our only true source of peace. God still promises he will never leave you nor forsake you. Heaven is still your final home by faith. The blip on the screen that's called the present and your earthly future is that quick. It's that quick. And what follows is heaven and home with him for those who believe in him. Close with this. Psalm 16:11. How's it all going to end? It's going to end because we'll be in his presence as believers in Christ. We've received him as our Savior, and we will be eternally in his presence. And what's in his presence? Fullness of joy. You haven't even begun to measure on the needle the amount of joy until you get to heaven. Okay? And Lord, at your right hand, there are what? Pleasures forevermore. America is pleasure crazy. America, you ain't seen nothing yet. Wait till you see the pleasures God has in store. Wow. Relax. God's in charge.